We are going to be discussing what an FRF is, or a frequency response function. We will be deriving equations for them, where they come from, and how we can use them to measure vibration in components. For this video, you're going to need to know a little something about what frequency is, and it would be very helpful to know what a differential equation is. If you're unsure what these are, that's okay. Pause the video and click these articles in the description. To start, let's imagine we have a strut in a car. The strut is very simple. They are basically the component of the car that absorbs all the shock and vibration events that your vehicle undergoes while you're driving. So if we were to zoom in, the car supported by the strut has some mass to it. It also has a damper, which is basically like a piston that absorbs some of those blows, and it's also connected to a spring. And we can model this as a spring mass damper system. This is a single degree of freedom system, meaning there is only one mass moving in one direction. This system models only one of the struts, and it's from this simple diagram that we can derive the equations that will create our FRF. We have roughly 1/4 the mass of the car supported by the strut, M, the spring constant of the strut, K, and the damping coefficient, C. To come up with an equation that's going to be useful, we need to find the sum of the forces. We will apply Newton's second law, which states that the sum of the forces is equal to mass times acceleration. Now, if we apply an oscillating force to the system, I'm going to call that F, it will begin to move up and down. We will call the displacement, or the distance it's moving up and down, X. So let's count all of our forces. We have the force of the spring and the force of the damper. Now we can begin to build a useful equation that'll help us model this behavior. The spring force is minus Kx, otherwise known as Hooke's law. You might remember that from physics, where K is the spring constant and X is that displacement. If you have a high K value, you're going to have a very stiff spring. But if your K value is really, really low, your spring's going to be very loose and behave something more like a slinky. Next, we have our damping force, which is minus Cx dot. If you're unfamiliar with dot notation, what we are doing is taking the derivative of displacement. So X dot would be the velocity. And the reason both C and K are negative is because they are pushing against our external force, and they are the restoring force of both the spring and the damper. So you have the external force minus the restoring force of the damper minus the restoring force of the spring is equal to mass times acceleration. And now we have the sum of the forces is equal to mass times acceleration. We can rewrite this a little easier, and we have the fundamental equation for looking at a spring mass damper system. If you're clever, you'll notice that this is a differential equation, and we need something that's going to be able to both model the up and down motion of our system and solve the differential equation. Okay, so I want to approach this in an intuitive way. Let's take a quick look at our system. As the mass bounces up and down, we get a cyclical displacement. The blue sine wave shows the motion of the mass. An important thing to observe is that our velocity is also acting cyclic, and so is the acceleration. We are going to need an equation where its derivatives look like the original. And I want you to just keep this in mind for now. Now we're going to make some assumptions. The first is that our solution is going to be linear and time harmonic. Time harmonic just means that the input forcing frequency is equal to the output displacement frequency. I've colored the forcing sine wave green so you can see that the force is acting on the system in an oscillating manner. And we want to make sure that what we're putting in is what we're getting out. For example, if the frequency of this wave was 10 Hertz on the input, this system will respond with 10 Hertz on the output. We don't want something that doesn't look linear. In this case, this orange signal has double the frequency. That would be not good, and our equations would not work for this. Okay, so we have this cyclical motion we are trying to model. Do any equations come to mind on what could model this? You may have thought of a few right away to help us out. Those would probably be sines and cosines, and then maybe something called e to the j omega t, where j is just a replacement for the imaginary number I. You could use I if you want, but here we are using j. Omega is the Greek letter that represents angular frequency in radians per second. This is a little different than using f for frequency because the units on that are in hertz. And then t just represents time. So e to the j omega t is also known as Euler's formula, and is just represented by sines and cosines. If you don't believe that this equation looks cyclical, I encourage you to pause, open up your nearest programming software, and plug it in and see if you get something that should look like this. Okay, so I've chosen Euler's formula as our solution, and the full equation is x is equal to x times Euler's formula, or that e to the j omega t. X is the maximum displacement, so what this is going to do is tell us where our displacement is based on our position in time, or where the mass is in the cycle. Now that we know what x is, we can look back at our original equation and start to do some replacements. We have x, but we don't have x dot or x double dot. So let's derive them. A friendly reminder that the derivative of e to the t is e to the t, and likewise the derivative of e to the 2t is 2e to the 2t. So we can just use the chain rule to derive. And this is great because if you think about this, now we have something where its derivatives are going to look like the original function, and we need that. Velocity is changing as mass bounces with acceleration, and now we have something to show that. Now we can take the derivative and end up with x dot. And if we take the derivative again, we're going to end up with a negative sign. You may have remembered that an imaginary number times an imaginary number is equal to negative 1. So now we have all of our x, x dot, and x double dot equations we need to substitute back into that original equation. So here's our original equation, and I'm going to show it with our new derivatives. We have this big mess of an equation that shows the time dependence for modeling this simple system. Notice the force part of the equation also has that e to the j omega t. As we mentioned, this is because we are oscillating the input. Now you may be thinking this is a video on frequency response, I want to talk about frequency, and you're talking about time, and you'd be correct. To calculate FRFs, we don't need the time dependence portion, and since it's on both sides of the equations, we can just cancel these out, and we're left with our final equation for calculating an FRF. There is one more step, but I'm going to leave this here first and explain what an FRF is before finishing. Now for the main event. So frequency response functions, or FRFs, tell us how a spring mass damper system will respond or behave based on the frequency, response. Because it's a response, it's modeled as some form of the measured output over the input. If I input a force, we can measure the output displacement, or how much it moves, and then we can plot the response. It's sometimes called the transfer function between the input and the output. It can be used to determine a bunch of different properties about a physical structure, used to find resonant frequencies, natural frequencies, damping, stiffness, and mode shapes for a structure. This peak is one of the key components of an FRF. It's called the natural frequency. The natural frequency is the rate at which an object oscillates when disturbed. An object will have the highest displacement at the natural frequency, where you will see it shake the most. The location of the natural frequency is calculated by taking the square root of k over m. Omega n, n for natural frequency, it's a great naming convention. You may be wondering where the imaginary component of the FRF is, since we had some imaginary numbers in our last equations. I've only plotted the amplitude here, and I've decided not to plot the phase portion of the FRF so that I can focus on the shape. The phase of the FRF is also very important, but for this video I will just be focusing on the amplitude. FRFs can be divided into three different zones. There is a stiffness-controlled zone, a damping-controlled zone, and a mass-controlled zone. What these zones mean is that these values are dependent on the spring constant, the damping coefficient, and the mass, respectively. Okay, if we go back to our equation, I have it right here as we left it. Now that we know an FRF is an output over an input, I can do that final manipulation. X is the output, F is the input, and if we rearrange, we get our final equation. And I'm going to celebrate this because this actually is our final equation. We call this equation reductance or compliance. There are many different types of FRFs, but this is the most basic one. It's the one we're going to focus on. So now that we have our FRF, I want to show you those stiffness and mass controlled zones and how they actually work. I'm going to start by exploring what happens when we change the damping value. So the original FRF has a damping value of 10 newton seconds per meter. If we increase it by a factor of 10, our natural frequency peak decreases. If I increase it again by a factor of 10, the peak begins to flatten and it isn't as sharp. It almost starts to disappear. And this makes sense if you think about what is practically happening in the real world. As you pad a system with damping, it isn't going to shake as violently. If I overlay the zones here, you should be able to see that by altering the damping, that red zone is what changes the most. Let's see what happens if we change the stiffness value. The original stiffness value for this FRF is 40 times 10 to the fifth newton meters. If we increase this by a factor of 10, we see that our natural frequency has shifted, but also the entire graph has shifted down. If I overlay those zones again, the portion most affected is that straight stiffness controlled line in the yellow zone. What is happening to this system in the real world is if you increase the stiffness of a system, the entire system as a whole will shake less. Imagine the difference between bouncing a bobblehead with a really loose spring versus bouncing a bobblehead with a very stiff spring. Lastly, I'm going to explore the changes in mass. So the original FRF had 10 kilograms of mass, and if I increase this to 1,000 kilograms, what I notice is that the natural frequency has shifted considerably, but that the straight stiffness controlled line has stayed the same. The reason the natural frequency has changed so much is because the mass is a key component of the fundamental equation for natural frequency, that square root of k over m. If I do an apples to apples comparison and overlay these, I can see that the shape of the graph most affected is the tail in that mass controlled zone. So adding or reducing mass will affect that shape portion of the graph. And before I leave, there's one last thing I just want to touch on so we can see how all of these click together. So if you've noticed what I've done now, I have flipped my input and my output. So instead of X over F, I now have F over X. And when I do that, I now have an upside down FRF. One thing you should notice is the scale has changed as well. We are now looking at scales of 10 to the ninth instead of 10 to the minus ninth. So the interesting part here is that that stiffness controlled line in the beginning of the graph actually tells you the stiffness value for your single degree of freedom system. Remember, that value was really high, 40 times 10 to the sixth. So using FRFs, you can pick out stiffness values from the graph. This type of FRF is called a dynamic stiffness FRF. And I think that's a pretty good name for it since it gives us the stiffness value. If you're thinking, this is really weird, how does the graph know the stiffness value? The reason for that's very simple. If we go back to the original FRF equation, when omega is really low or it equals zero, the mass portions and damping portions of the equation get multiplied by zero since that's where the omegas are attached to, and they cancel out. So you're only left with F over X equals K, that stiffness value. This phenomena also happens for other types of FRFs to give you damping and mass values, but those can be found in links in the description. I hope this has given you a basic understanding of what an FRF is.